unprepared. Preparations had been going on for weeks. It's there in hindsight on the 3rd of April, and I believe it to be true, that this was in a sense the Argentines being lured onto the punch. I'm not saying that she put up Galtieri to do this in the first place. What I am saying was that it was very definitely in the political interest of a prime minister lower in the opinion polls than any prime minister had been since opinion polls started at that time to let it run. You asked me about Francis Pym. I believe that Francis Pym was a basically honourable man. I believe that, like Lord Whitelaw, also a holder of the military cross, that he knew what war was about and was going to Washington in the belief that he would be able to do something about it. I didn't know till this morning what Malcolm Harper said about having not fixed up an official meeting with Perez de Cuellar, that this was all done through Anthony Parsons, and that is certainly a new fact. But you see, what is impossible to swallow about the Pym mission is, first of all, that he didn't contact the Americans on arrival, because he arrived by Concord. Secondly, that throughout the morning, he was with General Haig. He then went back to the embassy, and a phone call came through from Haig emphasizing the importance of the Peruvian proposals, wanting to speak to Francis Pym. But he didn't have time to speak to Haig. For why? He had a plane to catch. A plane to where? To New York. Now, services in high summer between Washington and New York aren't exactly infrequent. And as we heard this morning, this was a somewhat late engagement. The truth, as I believe it, was that he didn't want to be in the position of accepting the phone call, because had he done so, he would either have been in the position of deceiving the Americans, and if he deceived the Americans, how could he remain as Foreign Secretary dealing with our closest ally? Or he would have had to let the cat out of the bag that he had been told by London that something was afoot, not necessarily that the Belgrano was going to be sunk. So in one very real sense, the torpedo was not only fired at the Argentines, but I believe in one sense it was fired at Francis Pym, because the political situation was such that had anything gone wrong, Francis Pym moved to the Foreign Office, very much against the Prime Minister's wishes, would have certainly gone from the Foreign Office to Tam Dalyell MP. I believe, however, that the events of 1982, unfinished, reflect maximum discredit on those who made the key decisions. If I see to be personal to the Prime Minister, it's not a blanket attack on my political opponents, not the Conservative Party, not even the Cabinet, because it's a known fact, unchallenged, that for 33 days, as between April 2nd and May the 5th, Mrs. Thatcher never called together a full cabinet to discuss the conduct of the Falklands War. If I seem to be very personal, it's because the Falklands War was very personal to the British Prime Minister.
I'm told that I mustn't look at you, so that I'm pointing my voice towards this infernal machine here. I've been very impressed by what we've heard, a very frank and open statement. One's problem is that refers to evidence, and I don't doubt at all, but in some ways it runs counter to the evidence which the Foreign Affairs Committee had before them. I wonder whether Mr. Dalyell would like to comment on particularly the evidence of Charles Wallace. Is it his view that Charles Wallace didn't really have any serious knowledge of what was going on? Because in his evidence to the committee, he suggests that he didn't have anything which he could seriously communicate to the government.
I'm not going to get up in public and accuse a civil servant of lying. All I say to you was that I believe that Charles Wallace was put in an impossible position. I was at that hearing. I'm not sneering at him. He has a career. And it's a very, very impossible position for a civil servant to be put in. Because had Charles Wallace said anything different, he might have landed up in the position of Clive Ponting. I would rather leave it at that, but I believe when the full story comes to be told, that Charles Wallace's very personal dilemma, an impossible situation, will be revealed, and not to his discredit. I'm not going to attack him.